stop scrolling for a second so I can tell you about how much I love big trees and how important they are to forest ecology. So if you come out to one of my forest management projects, you'll notice a couple different things. One thing you'll notice is that it'll look like a mess with unlopped tree tops and trees laying on the ground everywhere. And another thing you'll notice is that there'll be a lot of big trees still there that will be marked with an L. That L stands for legacy, and we call them legacy trees or biological legacy trees. So the idea of these legacy trees is that within a managed forest, we also have trees that we're retaining solely for their ecological value. And these are not trees that we're going to cut later. These are trees that will never be cut. When we look at, say, old growth forests, which are this really good template for what forests have looked like here in Vermont for thousands of years, we see that they have a few different attributes. They have deep, well-developed soils. They have lots of dead wood on the ground. They have structural diversity, so many different sizes and ages of trees, and they also have some big trees. One of the misconceptions about old growth forests is that they're these areas with like all old trees, and that's just not true. What we see is more like 10 to 12 old trees per acre. If we're managing forests based solely on economics, there's a period that we call economic maturity. Economic maturity is a point at which a tree has maxed out its potential value relative to the risk of keeping it in the forest. So if you're thinking about your forest as a commodity or as an investment, that's the point at which that investment has matured and you cut that tree. There was another reason why you would cut a big tree, and that's because it was big and not valuable. So those trees were called decadent, and the thought was that they were just taking up space, taking up growing space that could be used to grow younger, thrifty trees. And so a lot of times these trees that had tremendous wildlife and ecological value, but actually no financial value, would be cut just to get them out of the way. And so we end up in this situation where if a tree is big and valuable, you cut it to capture that value. And if a tree is big and not valuable, you cut it to get it out of the way. And the result is that we never have any big trees in our forests. With many of our tree species, there are these amazing ecological values that they develop. And a lot of those values actually accrue after the tree reaches that point of economic maturity. So with a sugar maple tree like the one behind me, when it reaches 18 inches in diameter or 20 inches of diameter, you might say it's economically mature, but it may still have 200 years to live, during which time it will develop these really interesting and important attributes. Among those are complex bark structure, so deeply furrowed bark, which will have this really amazing habitat for a diversity of different invertebrates. We also see the development of some of these mosses, lichens, and bryophytes, stuff like liverworts, that may take centuries to develop that eventually establish on the bark of these old trees. We also see complex canopy structure. So in the canopy of these old trees, sometimes you'll have areas of the tree that are sort of alive and sort of dead and are harboring habitat for the species that utilize both living wood and dead wood. We'll also see cavities as that tree invariably develops internal rot, and invertebrates colonize that rotten wood, and then woodpeckers forage for the invertebrates and create these cavities, which are this incredibly important nesting and denning habitat for all kinds of birds and mammals and other critters. While you want to leave legacy trees that are healthy and that have the potential to live for hundreds of years, like the sugar maple tree behind me that has internal rot, these don't have to be the most financially valuable trees in the forest. In fact, trees that have, in some cases, greater ecological value are those with less financial value. So if you're a logger, you don't have to do anything extra. All you got to do is just not cut that tree that was going to be a pain in the butt to fell, and that was not going to be worth anything anyway. This is actually a process improvement that will make the work of loggers in the woods more efficient. At the same time, we need to recognize that the ecological benefits of forests don't solely come from big trees. These other attributes like deadwood on the forest floor, like structural diversity, that multi-generationality, that multi-layered canopy, are equally valuable to the ecology of this forest and to the creatures that live here, are equally underrepresented on our landscape as a result of past land use, and are attributes that we can develop by cutting big trees. So if you come out to one of my forest management projects, you're not just going to see legacy trees everywhere, you're also going to see the stumps of big trees that we've cut. Those two ideas, the stump of a big tree and a big tree that's being retained forever, are compatible and even complementary on our landscape. Big old trees are amazing, and leaving some big trees as legacy trees, in addition to cutting some big trees to create these other attributes that we know to be foundational to forest ecology, are both important parts of how we care for our forests. Please subscribe and make sure that your notifications are on so you'll be notified every time I put out a new video.